بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We have to move for the stage of evaluation and control strategy. How can you evaluate strategy? How can you control for strategy? The same story like even in management. You know, for management in general, we have the fourth functional area in management, or functional area in management, which is control. I mean, you had something, you had planned something, you formulate something, and now you want to, after implementation, you want to evaluate it, you have to judge. We have to, in this part, understand the basic control process. We have, how can we measure performance here? We can use the balanced scorecard approach to develop key performance measures. Maybe also we have to apply the benchmarking process to a function or to an activity, right? So this part is very easy and simple and clear. The first here, he said, what? Determine what to measure, establish a standard, measure, compare, and take what corrective, what action. As you see here in this figure, okay. Actually, the keywords here, we have to go for measuring performance. Performance, as a concept, very easy and simple, is the end result of activity. Is the end result of activity. I mean, we have to select measures to assess the performance based on blend objectives in strategic formulation stage, right? Very easy and simple. Okay. steering controls here. Steering here means directing controls. Measure what are variables. Measure variables that influence future profitability, right? What are the variables, the critical values that may affect or has some sort of impact on future profitability, such as if you are an airline company, okay, you are always looking to measure costs. If you are a retail company, you have to go for inventory turnover. If you have advertising or promotion or selling, you have to go for customer satisfaction, right? So we have performance in general is the end result of activity. Steering controls here, steering means directed controls. What are variables you have to measure? What are the variables that affect your future performance, your future objectives, such as what we said here, profitability, yep. Right? What are types of control? Types of control. I mean, we can control what? We can control output, our products, our service. We can control our employees' behavior, right? We can control our resources. I mean, which area we have to control? Which area we have to control? Okay, very brief about the area of output controls. He said what? Specify what is to be accomplished by focusing on the end result. Specify what is to be accomplished, what will be achieved. We have to specify that. So in this slide, controls can be established to focus on output. Maybe your output to be controlled: sales, cost reductions, profit. Another type of control about behavior. Behavior controls specify how something is done through policies. I mean, how can your employees behave through policies? I mean, through established policies, established rules. Do they obey these rules? Do they use these standard operating procedures? Do they use whatever policies? Suppose we have a policy, and we said before, what do you mean by policy? Policy, it is guidance in carrying out activities. We have HR policies, we have inventory policies, we have purchasing policies, we have hiring policies. Do our employees behave through these or apply these policies? Yes or no? We have to control that. Also, for behavior controls, focus on the activities that generate performance. I mean, behavior generate performance. This behavior is represented as some activities. Okay. For input controls, I mean, we can control our inputs. Maybe our inputs focus on resources that are used in performance. Okay. Maybe we can control about knowledge, skills, abilities, motivations, education, background, experience, time. Emphasize resources, whatever these resources, because these resources, we use some resources in our performance. We use behavior in our performance, right? So these are some of the most common three types of control. One of the most important or critical areas for control, he said, what? Activity-based costing. It is an accounting method very useful for value chain analysis. I mean, we have to allocate costs, direct or indirect, to individual product lines based on value-added activities going into that product. I mean, we have here to establish this product line. It has its own direct and indirect costs. What about its value-added? Maybe product line, maybe department, maybe division, whatever, right? Activity-based costing allocates indirect and direct costs to individual product lines based on value-added activities, okay? Allows accountants to charge costs more accurately since it allocates overhead more precisely, more accurately. I mean, they specify or identify for each product line or for each division, whatever, it's what costs, and comparing these costs with the amount of value added, right? This is very important for, okay. We have a lot of methods for measuring performance, okay, a lot of methods, such as balanced scorecard. Balanced scorecard is a very good approach when we go for evaluate and control the organization as a whole. I mean here the organization as a whole, here I mean its main activities, its main functional areas, its main, he said here, combines financial measures that tell results of actions already taken with C, operational measures on customer satisfaction, internal process of the corporation's innovation and improvement activities. I mean always, as I said, combine some areas inside the organization, or the main areas inside the organization, the main activities. So here we have financial activities or financial performance, customer activities, internal business perspective, and innovation and the learning. Here, here, yes, we have innovation and the learning from what? Operations, internal business perspective, customer, financial. Actually, they translate each area into what we call it responsibility center. And of course, the majority of you, you are working in organization or in real life. So they start to isolate a unit, used to isolate a unit, so it can be evaluated separately from the rest of the corporation. I mean, they make separate responsibility center. I mean, we have what we call it the revenue center, expense center, profit center, investment center, and each of these centers, each of them, they have their own responsibility about the performance in all over the organization. Okay, in financial, how do we appear to shareholders? In customer, how do customers view us? Internal business perspective, what must we excel at? What we are, what must be, have to be pioneer or better than others? Innovation and learning, can we continue to improve and create value to our product or to our area in or our activities or not, right? Another method for controlling, what we call it, benchmarking. We said before about benchmarking. In benchmarking, you compare yourself about pioneer. You compare yourself to a pioneer in the same industry. And we have to focus on pioneer as a word, because you cannot compare yourself with very small or very poor companies. Suppose you want to compare quality level, so you go for pioneer. You are in car automotive, so you are a small company or starting company or beginning company in the area of car automotive. You have to benchmark yourself to, or you have to compare yourself to Mercedes, Toyota, whatever. Okay, so of course you will find a gap between you and them, between you and them in any practice, in any activity, even in paying salary system, in motivating system, in HR activities. You compare yourself with this pioneer in this area, and as I said, you will find some sort of a gap. If you want to fill that gap, if you start to fill that gap, so you are what? Improving. But before improving, you have to measure these practices. And you use the pioneer as a standard. Okay? So here he said what? Benchmarking here. He said what? The continual process of measuring product, service, as I said, activities or practices, okay, against the toughest competitor. I mean, if you are still beginner in car automotive, Mercedes is considered as the toughest competitor, okay? Or Toyota is the toughest competitor for you. So the continual process of measuring product, service, right? And the practice again is the toughest competitors or those companies recognize it as industry what leader, right? And they have some here, she said, a continuous process of measure. Okay, we have here some steps for benchmarking. Identify the area or process to be examined. I mean, you have to select which area, which practice you have to examine. What you want to examine, the area of design, the area of quality control, the area what? You have to identify that. And you have to find behavioral or output measures. Okay? You have to, what will be the standards, okay, standard of your output. How can you measure your output? Find behavioral and output measures. Select an accessible set of competitor of best practices. What? You compare yourself with Toyota and Honda, or Toyota and Mercedes, or what? Select an accessible set of practices of competitors or best practices to benchmark, to learn how they achieved the excellence in that area, in that practices. Step 4, calculate the differences among the company's performance measurement and those of competitors and determine why the difference exists. Maybe you have to go for the impact, the time, the cause, the location, and you have to diagnose why the differences exist. Why the differences exist, right? Develop tactical programs of closing performance gaps. I mean, you have to establish some tactical programs, detailed programs, how to close the gap between you and these pioneers, and start to implement the programs and compare what the results. If you do that, you can guarantee some sort of progress. And because we have measuring here, so it is what one step of measuring or evaluation or controlling your what.